Good morning to all of you. Welcome back to Hospitality Engineering, HVAC Module 2 Part 3. Last video, we saw HVAC system mainly on vapor compression system. In HVAC system, there are 5 type of refrigeration systems are available. They are vapor compression system, air cycle system, observation system, thermoelectric and evaporative cooling system. Here we will go through again vapor compression system. The main component of the vapor compression system, compressor. Compressor is the heart of the system. The compressor receives the low temperature, low pressure refrigerant and compresses to the high pressure, high temperature refrigerant, which goes to the condenser. In condenser, condensing is happening. A high pressure, high temperature gas condenses into the high pressure, high temperature liquid. The liquid moving and coming to the expansion tube or expansion valve, where pressure is reduced. While pressure is reduced drastically as required by the evaporator, the temperature also reduced. This low temperature saturated vapor comes into the evaporator, where it started to evaporate by cooling the chilled water. This evaporator gas, again when it comes, it becomes the dry low pressure low temperature gas which collected in the accumulator. From accumulator, this low temperature low pressure gas goes to the compressor. Thus this cycle is continuing in the vapor compression system. Now we will move into the air cycle system. Air cycle system. When you see this picture, it is very clear this type of system only possible in the aircraft. You can see here there is a compressor. Compressor is a reciprocating compressor. The piston moves up and down. While the pistons move towards your right, the suction valve open, then air enters inside. Then the piston moves towards the left side, it compresses. Then this gases goes to the heat exchanger. From heat exchanger, it goes to the expansion device. Then directly that cold air used for the space cooling purposes. This is what air cycle system function. You can see in this picture. Now I will go through the by sentence. In the system, air from the refrigerated space enters the compressor that increases its pressure and temperature. The air then passes through the heat exchanger, which cools the high pressure air to the temperature near the outside ambient temperature. Next, the air moves through an expansion device that reduces the air pressure to that of the refrigerated space. The expansion also reduces the temperature to the value lower than that of the refrigerated space. Finally, the chilled air is allowed to enter the space where it mixes with the warmer air, reducing its temperature. Now, we will see vapor observation refrigeration system. So, which is widely used in the industry where we have lot of waste heat availability. If we have the waste heat availability, the vapor observation refrigeration system is most suited refrigeration for the space cooling. Now, here in this picture, you can see there is an absorber. This is called an absorber. Then you can see this is a condenser. Then this is an evaporator. Cooling tower is there. Then there is a hot water tank, one pump also there. You can see this hot water tank pump connected with the absorber. The remaining, if you take it out, this absorber, pump and hot water tank, the system is similar to that of your vapor compression system. The only difference is compressor is replaced with absorber, pump and hot water tank. In this system, a refrigerant fluid sequentially moves through the component of the system. Second, the refrigerant moves through a condenser, expansion device and evaporator, similar to the vapor compression cycle. The difference lies in how the low pressure, low temperature refrigerant vapor is changed to high pressure, high temperature vapor. In the absorption cycle, the vapor leaving the evaporator is absorbed by the liquid solutions in a vessel called an absorber. This is an absorber. The vapor is turned ammonia and the liquid that absorbs the vapor is turned water. Mainly here, the refrigerant what we are using is ammonia and the absorb the vapor is the water. A little more further deep, we will see the vapor absorption system. There are the single effect and double effect absorption system. You can see here, there is a double effect absorption system. This yellow color, here you can see there is an absorber. Then there is a pump also there in the absorber. How you can see this pump, this, you know, absorbent and spray on this tube. You can see here. Then you come back here, there is another low temperature generator pump. It pumps the liquid. Here you can see it goes to the low temperature generator. So these are no waste heat availability place, most suited to this system. Then again, you can see here another pump which goes back to the steam fired generator. So this yellow line is a main area which is replacing the compressor. The other side, you can see the blue, which is creating a chilled water. The double effect absorption process is similar to that described above single effect, except that generator, condenser and heat exchangers are added. The refrigerant vapor from the primary generator runs through a heat exchanger called secondary generator. Before entering the condenser, the secondary generator with the hot vapor on one side of the heat exchanger boils some of the lithium bromide and refrigerant solution, which is called a weak solution, creating the double effect. The double effect absorption process is significantly more energy efficient than the single effect absorption process, which we have seen in previous one. Absorption chiller refrigeration cycle, vapor compression chiller refrigeration cycle. Now you can see the differences here. Here there is a generator, pump, absorber. This green area is replaced by the compressor in the vapor compression system. This compressor is replaced by the generator, pump and absorber in the vapor absorption system. Remaining, if you see, both are similar component. Thermoelectric system. What do you mean thermoelectric system? You can see there are two different type of material. You can see N and P, which tend to generate a heat at the one junction and produces a cold surface at the other junctions. When one side heat is dissipated, other side is cold surface is, you know, coming. So the picture is, you know, self-explanatory. Now I will go through it. Semiconductor material there that could support the commercial refrigerations. Due to the material metallurgy developments, the semiconductors are very much developed today. So it is possible in this method we can able to provide the refrigeration effect. They depends on the Peltier effect, which states that when an electric current passes through the junctions of two dissimilar material, the flow of charge carriers will tend to generate the heat at one junction and produce a cold surface at the other junction. Consequently, a cold surface is generated where heat may be absorbed. Now, we will come back to the natural cooling. It is evaporative cooling. We all know what is a evaporative cooling. So, you can see here, there is a fan, then there is a cooling pad. The hot air is coming and passing through the cooling pad. While the air passes through cooling pad, above there is a water spray. The water spray is coming inside. The same what is happening in the cooling tower, same effect is happening here. While this hot air is coming, it gets wetted. Then when it is moving here, it reaches to the wet bulb temperature. The cold, high humid air goes to the occupant area. This is simple diagram of the evaporative cooling. There are two types of evaporative coolings are available: direct evaporative cooling and another one is indirect evaporative cooling. Cooling tower is a heat rejection device which discharges warm air from the cooling tower to the atmosphere through the cooling of water. In the HVAC industry, the term cooling tower is used to describe both open and closed circuit heat rejection equipment. There are two types of evaporative cooling: direct evaporative cooling and indirect evaporative cooling. What is direct evaporative cooling? You can see here, there is a fresh air, it goes, then there is a humidifier where the water mist is given here. After this fresh air mixed inside the humidifier, it get wet, then that goes to the supplier. Then we have the return air. This return air, after it heated, the air is taken back and exhausted to ambient. So this is called the direct evaporative cooling. Direct evaporative cooling requires 100% outdoor air and exhausted capability. There are two general type of direct evaporative cooling system: spray type air washer and wetted media type cooler. This is most suited to the cross ventilation area like kitchen, you can able to use laundry, also you can able to use in hotel. Direct evaporative cooling, spray type air washer. Spray type air washers are versatile. They can use chilled water from a refrigeration system when the outdoor air wet bulb temperature is high. They can also provide the cooling without chilled water when the outdoor air is suitable for the conventional evaporative cooling. Basically, when you have the low RH, you can use the evaporative cooling. When you have the high RH, you have to use the chilled water. Wetted media type cooler. The wetted media type cooler is a box with perforated sides containing a water supply and a blower fan. Each side of the box is lined with a wetted pad of material. The blower fan draws air into the box through the wetted media. The warm air gives up heat to the water in the pad and cool air is provided to the space. Indirect evaporative cooling. The name itself explains it is an indirect evaporative. There is no mix of water with the air. You can see here the fresh air, this yellow line, it is taken. There is a humidifier. Then heat recovery wheel or heat recovery device is there where the heat transfer is happening. So the from cold air low heat and hot air, the while this exhaust goes, it heat up. The fresh air is heat up through the cold exhaust. Indirect evaporative cooling broaden the application range into other zones and occupancies. Secondary air, outdoor air or exhausted air is cooled by the evaporation on one side of the heat exchanger. The primary supply air is on the other side of the exchanger and is indirectly cooled through the heat exchanger walls. As a result, no moisture is added to the primary air, although it is sensibly cold. The living tri-bulb temperature of the primary air cannot be lower than the entering wet bulb temperature of the secondary air. And indirect evaporative cooler can be arranged as a pre-cooler, and the system exhaust can be used to enhance the effectiveness of a condenser coil. Now, direct evaporative cooling, fresh air, the cold water humidifier, after it become the high humid air, then it goes through the blower, the supply air. Whereas in indirect evaporative cooling, fresh air, then there is a heat recovery device, the exhausted air, then extract air and supply air. So what it is happening in the indirect evaporative cooling, the fresh air cooled by the exhaust air. So this pre-cooling is happening in the heat recovery device. Thank you for watching. If you are not subscribed, please subscribe Hospitality Engineering. If you have any suggestion or any comments, please contact me. Thank you for watching.